podcast is part of the Sports Social Podcast Network.
Hello and welcome to 1865, the Nottingham Forest podcast. I'm your host, Steven Toplis. It's Friday the 4th of October and it's time for Friday 5. With Forest about to play their final Premier League match before the international break, there's been plenty to cover from the past 7 days at the City Ground. I'm joined by George Edwards for this week. Welcome, George.
Hi, Stephen. You all right?
I am good, thanks. Are you?
Yeah, so good, mate. Thank you. All good.
Now, Jamie Martin isn't here this week, but in his absence, we've got Rich Ferraro with the top Forest stories of the week. Over to Rich.
Hi, it's Rich here at the 1865 News Desk this week, sitting in while Jamie takes a little break. Here are the top stories from the City Ground in the last 7 days. Let's start with a story that just escaped our news deadline last Friday as coach Steven Reid has left the Reds again. The Irishman was in his second spell at the City Ground, having been first appointed under Chris Hughton and supporting Steve Cooper during that memorable promotion season. Reid then took a break from football coaching to focus upon becoming a mental health expert before returning to the club under Cooper. Understandably, his role perhaps became a little less prominent after Nuno brought in his own coaching team, but memorably, he got charged by the FA for swearing at officials in the wake of the controversial 1-0 defeat at home to Liverpool. Reid announced his departure via Instagram, and this was confirmed by the club shortly afterwards, saying that he leaves with their best wishes. Thanks for everything, Stephen. Next, and possibly the biggest story of the week, there's been another change in the Reds boardroom, as Tom Cartledge has stepped down as chairman after just over a year at the helm. His predecessor, Nicholas Randall KC, once again takes the chair, despite rumours that he'd previously lost the confidence of Reds owner Evangelos Marinakis. Randall had retained his place on the board throughout, and although Cartledge is planning to focus upon his own business interests, he too will sit on the board of directors, where presumably his expertise on planning and architecture will still come in handy as the Reds look to redevelop the world-famous City Ground. Cartledge had become unpopular amongst some of the club's fanbase with the assertion that Forest could move to Toton sidings, but those plans have been kicked into touch, with Marinakis firmly stating that he thinks the Reds' home should be on Trentside. Third, Reds legend Viv Anderson auctioned off some memorabilia from a glittering career for Forest and England. Nottingham Forest bought Viv's European Cup winners' medal from the 1980 final against SV Hamburg, with Evangelos Marinakis making a personal intervention to meet the reserve price and apparently making a generous donation on top. Viv had said that he wanted to sell some items to provide financial support for his children, but unfortunately, another piece of history, his England shirt from his groundbreaking debut for his country as England's first black player, did not meet the reserve price. Still, good luck for the future, Viv. Now, a story that is not Forest-specific but does concern football fans everywhere. The founding chairman of Kick It Out, Lord Herman Ouseley, has passed away at the age of 79 following a short illness. Not only do we at 1865 support the aims of the charity, but regular listeners will know that our contributor Ellie Mollison has been doing some great work with Kick It Out to reduce sex and gender-based discrimination in football, so it's not just about race. Rest in peace, Lord Ouseley, a pioneer in making the beautiful game accessible to all. Finally from the news desk, Forest's unbeaten run in the Premier League came to an end with defeat against Fulham at the City Ground last week, so do remember to check our match report in your podcast feed where we discuss tactics and team selection and so on. But the Reds are still in the top half of the table and will be looking to bounce back away at Chelsea on Sunday. Morgan Gibbs-White should be available to return on Sunday against Chelsea after serving his one-match ban last weekend. Even better, the magnificently mustachioed midfield maestro has received another call-up to Lee Carsley's England squad, a real vote of confidence after he missed out on his second cap against Finland as the new England manager took a look at other players. There'll be an interview with Morgan on Football Focus this Saturday, which is currently available on the BBC Sport website. So those are your top five stories, but just time for a late entry before our recording deadline. The club are supporting Notts County fan Vicky McClure because they're offering Vicky's Dementia Choir a long-term rehearsal space. A grand gesture, I'm sure you'll agree. This has been Rich Ferraro at the 1865 News Desk. If you like what you hear, then please leave a review for 1865 via your podcast app or simply share our show with your friends. All our links are available at 1865, that's the word, 1865.football. Now it's back to Stephen and George in the studio.
Thanks, Rich. And those were the top stories from the City Ground this week. And now let's have a look at those in a bit more detail, George. So starting with the first story, which was Steven Reid. He has left Forest's coaching staff for the second time. And it was announced by him on Instagram this week and then soon confirmed after by the club. Now, I would say Steven Reid has been one of the most important figures in Forest's recent history when you think of his involvement in the team and the coaching staff under Steve Cooper. They got promoted to the Premier League in 2022. He kick-started in some way that season with that caretaker victory over Huddersfield. And despite leaving the club, he then returned under Cooper again and remained on the coaching staff when Nuno took charge. So what's your reaction to Steven Reid leaving the club again for a second time?
I think firstly, it's not much of a surprise because of the manager that we've got in charge. We saw that Cooper, towards the end of his tenure, brought in that set-piece coach. Was it Simon Rusk, who got nowhere near having a sort of sniff at it? So I think the fact that Reid was even included and brought along for as long as he was a bit of a surprise, because Nuno is a man, as a lot of foreign coaches are, that likes to bring his own people in and surround himself with them to make him feel comfortable, which, you know, you absolutely have to agree with. But yeah, I think it was a bit sad to see that, because Steven's been possibly more than Cooper, more than Yates, the only bit of solidity we've had over the past 3 or 4 years. He was here before in COVID, I think, and then in through Houghton as well, stayed in that Huddersfield game. And I don't know, he must have had some contact with Cooper thinking before the game, because it was pretty much guaranteed he was going to be the manager anyway, wasn't it, before the Huddersfield game? So maybe that came from Cooper. But the fact that Reid set the team up and gave them the confidence to release the shackles, I think it was a real moment of relaxing. And, you know, we've got this. Yes, we're bottom of the Championship, but we've got the capability to come in. Let's have a new start. And from there, obviously, Cooper came in, and alongside him and Tate, we went up the league and into the Premier League. So, yeah, it's a sad day to see Steven go. I think what he's done for the club, I think we can't forget. And in fact, that period under Cooper when he wasn't there, I think we were weaker, so his impact can be shown then. The Liverpool thing Rich mentioned as well, he likes to get himself involved, which we just loved. So, yeah, I think he's a really popular figure in the fan base. It's sad to see him go, and we wish him luck with whatever he's doing next.
We will now look at our second story that Rich brought us, and quite a significant one as well. So Tom Cartledge has stepped down as Forest chairman. He has been replaced by the returning Nicholas Randall. And I think it's fair to say, George, that Cartledge was quite a divisive chairman, and I don't think we'll forget his time in the position in a hurry. What is your thoughts on Cartledge's exit and what this means for the direction of Forest moving forward, particularly with the City Ground developments and the aftermath of the Toton sidings plans?
Yeah, this was the big shot, wasn't it? I don't think anyone saw this, and it was just dropped on the Forest services Twitter feed or something, and we were like, oh really, wow, because he's only been in the door 5 minutes, hasn't he, for a chairman anyway, to give the fact that we had Randall here for 6 years before that, and obviously before that it was Fowler as well, he was owning the club. So for him to be there for this short of time, it, you know, it is a bit weird. You maybe think, are the club thinking it was a rash decision to put him in place in the first place, because it was obviously pretty clear why he came in, because the club were driving redevelopment and driving a new era for the club. And, you know, you've got to speculate about these things because nobody knows the real reasons why. But a part of me thinks maybe it was Marinakis who actually wanted Toton, wanted to put Cartledge at the front of that. And then obviously the fans said, you know, if we've got anything to do with that, that isn't happening. And he thought, you know, Cartledge can just be there in the background supporting that. We'll get the man back in who's a bit more well-rounded. I think it was weird because we've only sort of seen the start of the development, the new Dear Carby Tower, or whatever we're calling it, that's assembled in the corner of the Brian Clough and the Trent End's just started. So that was sort of the beginning, and then cartilage is out the door. So I think they've made it pretty clear that he'll still be involved in the club and he's not completely gone. And in terms of his tenure, I can't say that I've been a huge fan of it, in fairness. I think off the pitch, they've got a lot wrong. I mean, you look at the recruitment under him, and I don't know how much he has involved in recruitment, because we've got Syrianos back to do that, and we know that Marinakis likes to have a say. So I'm not 100% sure if Cartledge would have had a say in recruitment, but you've got to say that in the period he's been at the club, we've recruited well on the pitch, and we've got the right manager in, I think. So you've got to give him credit for that, if he can take credit. But I think off the pitch, in terms of the communications with the fans, it's been a shambles. The upping people's season tickets ridiculous amounts, and then goading them. I think the communication and the breakdown in relationship between the clubs has been clear to see there. And, you know, it doesn't surprise me really that this has happened. I think Randall is a surprise, because he sort of didn't go out with the best reputation. I remember the sort of interview that he did with the club about us not having any PSR issues, or I think it was with the Supporters Trust. And then obviously a few months later, we did have PSR issues. So that didn't make him look great. But I think Randall epitomises the good times we've had at the club. You know, he was at the front of the club appointing Dame Murphy, who then appointed Cooper, and he got that right. He seems to have a good relationship, or if it was damaged, repaired the relationship with Marinakis. He seems to be a guy that Marinakis trusts. And he just feels like the sort of authoritarian figure at the front of the club that I could see there for another sort of 6 or 7 years. So, yeah, I think it's something that doesn't surprise me, to be fair. And Marinakis does like to have his men in charge, and Randall seems to be one of them.
Yes, and it does feel like Tom Cartledge was brought in for a particular purpose. That purpose has now ended, and as a result, he is no longer Forest chairman. It was actually 15 months he was in charge, so just over a year all in. Longer than some Forest managers, actually. So he's that's a bit of an achievement for him. But yeah, I think it's fair to say we won't be calling the newsstand Cartledge Corner anytime soon. And yes, welcome back to Nicholas Randall QC, back as chairman at Forest. Our next story is involving a Forest legend and Viv Anderson. The sale of his memorabilia from his footballing career. Now, among his memorabilia were a couple of notable items: his England shirt from his debut against Czechoslovakia in 1979, which was significant because that was the game in which he became the first black player to win a full England cap. And in auction this week, that didn't meet the reserve price. Also up for sale was his 1980 European Cup medal, the second one that he won with Forest in that famous final against Hamburg in Madrid. And Forest have bought this medal from Viv Anderson, with Evangelos Marinakis stepping in to make a bid, and he's also included a bonus contribution on top of that. I think this is a really nice story, George, because it's good to see that the club have stepped in and purchased this memorabilia, this significant piece of memorabilia involving not only a club legend, but also one of the most memorable, if not the most memorable night in the club's history, the night they won two European Cups back to back. And tying in with the new Forest Museum, I would imagine that this will now take pride of place in that new museum in the Trent End.
Yeah, it would look very good there, and there's a lot of nice touches in there. The Larry Lloyd shirt springs to mind when I went there. That was pretty powerful because obviously passed not long ago, and then that was in there. That was a really powerful thing. I think what struck me the most about this story was the difference in times. I don't think, if you think about current professional football players, I don't think they'd be having to worry about funding the next four generations. But the fact that such a trailblazer, such a memorable player for us and for England, has got to do this to support his family, it shows how the times have changed. Because, yeah, I don't think a current player would have to combat that. But, yeah, it's the second week in a row that we've seen a story like this from Marinakis. I think last week he helped a club in the community, didn't he, that we were mentioned on the show. And then this week, obviously, this. He just proven to be a brilliant person for Nottingham. I think he's an advocate for the city, and the club have done really well here. I think, I'm not sure how much of it was driven by him, but if it was from him, I think we've got to give him huge credit. And it's similar to the story we'll mention later about the choir thing that he's done overall this week. It just seems that Marinakis is in a really good place with Nottingham. He seems like he's in touch with the city and he's got a real affinity and love for it. We've seen the Trent Rocket story that he wants to look at purchasing them as well. So I think we're lucky to have somebody at the top of the club who is willing to buy into the place that we love, that we've grown up in, that we cherish. And he's, you know, he's an outsider, came in from Greece, probably didn't know much about Nottingham. And what, 7-8 years on, it seems like he's one of our own. So yeah, he's a really good person to have at the top of the club. And that's just adds to the list of great things that he's done.
Breaking news coming in from Bet365, where every nail-biting overtime win, breakaway, pick six, three-point shot, underdog win, buzzer beater, shootout, walk-off, and absolutely every play in between is amazing. From football to basketball and hockey to baseball, whatever the moment, it's never ordinary at Bet365. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. 21 plus only. Must be physically located in Virginia.
You're listening to 1865, the Nottingham
Podcast. Welcome back. It's Stephen here and I've still got George with me. And the next story, George, is news that the anti-racism campaigner and the founder of Kick It Out, Lord Herman Ouseley, has passed away at the age of 79. Lord Ouseley was the chair of Kick It Out from its launch in 1993. He held that post for 25 years and never received any money for his work with the charity, incredibly, but just shows you the character of the man and the trailblazer that he was for football in this country and worldwide as well.
Yeah, definitely. It's a sad day, but it's a day where we get to reflect on his incredible work, what he's done for football. I think Kick It Out has become such a renowned charity in helping players, fans, managers overcome issues that have been in football for far too long. And thankfully are on the way out, probably mainly down to him because the campaigns, the traction, the fact that everybody seems to buy into them. I mean, I still remember one of my most fond memories as a young child growing up was we played Rotherham away and they had these warm-up Kick It Out shirts and Ben Osborne threw one at me and I think I wore it for about a week. I've still got it in my wardrobe. But that just shows how, you know, football at all level bought into what he did. And I'm at university now. We had a talk from Troy Townsend, who's from Kick It Out now as well, Andrus Townsend's dad. And it's clear that that company have got so much going for them. Everybody, not just across football, but across sport and across life, really, see what they're doing, think it's absolutely incredible. And, you know, we've got Ellie working close with them as well. I think it's such an incredible charity, such a needed charity. And I think we've got to remember the guy because what a bloke. He's done so much for so many people that we won't even know about. And he truly should never be forgotten and will be cherished, I think, by everybody to do a Kick It Out forever.
Yeah, it's an incredible legacy that he leaves behind and one which will carry on for generations. I think the work is so important that Kick It Out do, and it's something that is, of course, very close to our hearts here at 1865. And as you say, Ellie is involved in work with Kick It Out. And yes, long may that good work continue. On to our final story then, and we look ahead to Forest's next game away at Chelsea on Sunday, but also reflect on the fact that Forest's unbeaten run is now over in the Premier League, beaten by Fulham at home 1-0 on Saturday afternoon. And much has been said about that game, George, and the tactics and the setup against Fulham. And we've got our match report in the can. Do go back and have a listen to that if you haven't already. But looking ahead now to this game on Saturday at Chelsea, Morgan Gibbs-White should return to the side following his suspension. And Forrest, the only thing they've got to worry about is Cole Palmer, who is fresh off the back of four goals against Brighton the weekend just gone. And he's, alongside Morgan Gibbs-White, been called up to the England squad by Lee Carsley. So we're going to have two England attacking midfielders up against one another at Stamford Bridge on Sunday. How do you see it going? And do you think that Forest are really going to change things up from the Fulham game after what happened?
Yeah, I don't think we should dwell on Fulham too much. I think Adam and Baz have probably touched on it plenty, but it didn't really fill me with much confidence how Nuno seemed to lose confidence in the squad without Morgan, without one player, because I'd have just loved to see Anderson playing in the 10. I think we bought him and I was really excited because finally we had some competition for Morgan, and particularly a home game, because I think we've not won in about 6 or 7 home games now. I think that's because we seem to set up like the away side at home. And against Fulham, they're a good side. They've got some good players and they've had, I think, their best ever Premier League start. But they're not a side that we should be scared of or change our style for. So that's what frustrated me about that. But in terms of Chelsea, it wouldn't surprise me if Nuno didn't make many changes. I think Morgan will obviously come back in. He plays every game if he's fit, if he's available. But you're probably going to compare it to Liverpool. It's a similar sort of game, going away at a game that you're not fancied. And Nuno might think, you know, yes, it didn't work against Fulham, but that's a completely different context. That's at home against a side where we're expected to be pretty even against. In fact, against Chelsea, I highly doubt we're expected to dominate the ball, to get forward that often. So I wouldn't be surprised if we had a similar setup. And obviously, we don't want to be as open as Brighton were last weekend. I think their high line was absolutely baffling. I don't think that's going to be something that we try. I think we've never really played with a high line. And yes, we've got the pace a bit more. And I think Milenkovic is quicker than he looks. Moreno's obviously got pace. And then in particularly Aina and Moreno in the back four, we have got that. But I'm not too sure whether that's the way to go. I think we've just got to maybe do a similar performance to Liverpool away. So yeah, I think it'll be a good match. I think Forest are confident away from home and they won't be scared by the challenge that Chelsea or Palmer face. Obviously, you've got to be aware of it because it's ridiculous. The guys, I think he scored 20 Premier League home goals in 19 games at Stamford Bridge or something like that. It's completely ludicrous. And you know, when you've got a player that special in that much form, yeah, you've got to have some sort of mitigating circumstance for it. But yeah, I think Morgan will come back in, hopefully impresses in front of Palmer and chose him who should be starting next week, because I was at the game, I forgot who we played, but we played the England game at Wembley in September, ready to see Morgan, and he didn't get on the blooming pitch. So that needs to happen this time, please, Lee. But yeah, Morgan's a credit to the club, getting another call-up. It doesn't surprise me, obviously. He didn't play the last match and he didn't have his best form in September. But it's clear that Lee Carsley trusts him and really buys into what he's about. And I really hope that he just goes and shows what he's about, represents the football club in such a professional way as he always does. And hopefully he plays in both games and off the back of a win at Stamford Bridge. We can hope, can't we?
Hopefully, yes. That game was Finland. That Gibbs White didn't feature in because England are playing Finland again. But also playing Greece, and I'm sure one Odysseus Lakodimos will be making an appearance at some point in that run of fixtures. But yes, I think it's great news that Gibbs White is back in the England squad, and hopefully he can add to the one cap that he's got already. Significantly, though, not only has Cole Palmer returned to the England squad, but so too Jude Bellingham and Phil Foden. So you wonder if there is going to be a spot for Morgan to come in with those options at number 10 back in the England squad. But from his point of view, this is an opportunity to get in there and try and impress and force his way in ahead of the likes of Bellingham and Foden.
Yeah, he always relishes challenges, doesn't he? I don't think he's one to shy away from it. I think he'll embrace being with some of the best attacking players, not just in England or in the English game, but in world football. Bellingham's up for the Ballon d'Or. Palmer's surely been nominated, and Foden has as well. And Foden, let's be honest, hasn't really done it in an England shirt. So if Morgan gets his chance, I think he's got to take it. Like you mentioned, I think given the circumstances of who's involved, I'm not sure how much game time he will get, particularly because I thought it was going to be between him and Angel Gomez, but he really impressed me in that Finland game. I thought he expressed himself really well, played a bit further back than I thought he would, but he was sort of in the eight role, really did well. So I wouldn't be surprised to see Gomez more than Morgan. But yeah, the fact Morgan's just in this conversation, and it's not really been reported on really that Morgan's in the squad. So that shows the sort of the fact that nobody's really surprised in his quality, in the fact that Carsley's backing him. And, you know, if he can keep performing like that for Forest and keep showing the professional attitude he does for England, then you know, it's going to keep not becoming a surprise, and we're going to keep praising him, and hopefully he'll be in England squads for years to come. I think that depends on who the FA appoint as manager. It looks like Carsley does really back him, and if they get somebody else like Howe or Tuchel, I think there's been a report that they've not contacted those blokes, but if they go in a different direction, you wonder whether there is chances will be limited. But while they keep him coming, I'm sure he'll try and take them and thrive in training and absolutely relish the chance.
And our final story, our bonus story for this week's Friday Five, is that Forest have offered Vicky McClure's Our Dementia Choir a new long-term rehearsal space at the City Ground. This is a community choir that was set up a few years ago by Vicky McClure, and it's a gesture that has been made by the Forest owner, Evangelos Marinakis, which will see Our Dementia Choir use the Robin Hood Suite at the City Ground for practice sessions and social gatherings. And as we were talking about earlier, it really does underline his commitment to supporting the local community and local causes.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we've mentioned it all earlier, haven't we? But it's very rare to see an owner. I think you can see with Sheikh Mansour maybe at Man City, but an owner who isn't a sort of boyhood fan or somebody that's been involved in the English game for a while come into a foreign body and buy into it so much and be so committed to driving positivity, driving change, and not just pumping money into the football club and trying to get success on the pitch, but actually seeing Nottingham as a wider place and sort of throwing his money into that and getting behind that and being an advocate of it. We see him at games all the time. I mean, I sit in the Brian Clough stand opposite where he is sat, so he's a very prominent figure there. And yeah, he's just a brilliant man to have at the top of the football club. And to do it for Vicky McClure, I think Rich mentioned she's a Notts fan, but she is somebody as well who's so much about Nottingham. She's got something to do with the television workshop that I was at as well. And Ellie, I know, used to go there as well, which is such a brilliant organisation, the television workshop, allowing kids of all sort of backgrounds to try and get into performance and arts. And so many good people have came from that. And I know Vicky's such an advocate for that as well. So it's nice to see him support someone like Vicky, who I have so much credit for as well. And it's another fantastic story to add to the list, like I mentioned earlier.
Yep, and it is brilliant to see the club so involved with the community and helping incredible causes and very worthy causes such as this. So we'll leave it there then. That brings us to an end to this week's Friday Five. My thanks to Rich Ferraro for providing the roundup. Thanks also, George, for joining me. It's been a pleasure. And thank you, listener, for coming along as well and listening. We will have our match report after the Chelsea game on Sunday. We'll also have another roundup of the latest goings on with the Nottingham Forest women's team. So if you haven't already, please do subscribe. Do tell your friends. Do leave us a 5-star review in your podcast provider. All those things help to share and promote our content. Thanks again, and until next time, we'll see you soon.
Is part of the Sports Social Podcast Network.